organization and they'll say, can you build us a direct mail program? Can you, or we need to get into digital. These kind of things where the channel is coming first without an identification of the audience. So we have really seen that those organizations that start out with their audience in mind, figuring out who are their natural supporters now, who is their target audience to try to turn into supporters, and then developing channels and messages to reach those people. Those are the organizations that really are donor-centered or supporter-centered, and those are the ones that are most successful. So part of that tip is also knowing your supporters. And this is something that I think the charity sector, and I've worked agencies and I've worked within numerous charitable organizations in Vancouver and the UK. We're not anywhere as good at this as you'll find most of the big retailers and corporates and advertising agencies. So I've this is kind of a pen portrait or a customer profile that's typical of what a large retailer might do to kind of identify who their customer profile is, who's their typical customers, where do they live, what are their demographics, but also what are their values, you know, what makes them tick, what kind of messages you need to give to motivate those folks. I would argue that in the charitable sector, our insight into our donors very often stops here. Right, so we'll start working with an organization. Tell us about your supporters. Who are your donors, for example? Well, they're 65-year-old women, 65-year-old and older women. And that's where a lot of organizations stop still in understanding who their supporters are. And there's a lot to be, that's true. There's a lot to be said. There's a lot of donors who are 65-year-old women. But if we can develop more insight into who these people are, then we can develop our messages much in a much more sophisticated fashion as well as our strategies. So ways to find out a little bit more. There's lots of research into age groups. This is the Stettler company who've done some information on the motivators and unmet needs of different people based on age. But if I take this as a pen portrait that we developed, and if I could take this is a particular donor group. These are legacy donors for one particular organization. So we spend some time delving into who their people were. I actually just used a picture of my mom, so I haven't stolen it from space. Well, I did, but I think I have lifelong permission to do so. So that's just her. But this particular organization who got us to dive a little bit deeper into who was going to leave them legacies, who was leaving them legacies, and why. And I think this just is developing a pen portrait like this, or a profile like this really helps us when we come to write copy, really helps us when we come to, you know, helps organizations when they're trying to brief their client giving officers about going out and having visits and the kind of things you want to talk about. So why has Julie, for example, named five charities in her will? And so Julie has named five charities at least, and I'm sure that actually some of them are probably here in this room. And they range from children's charities to environmental causes to homelessness. And some very, very specific ones as well that have helped people she loves. So when we delve into why Julie is supporting, and again, this is just one example of one kind of supporter group, she is leaving a legacy because she wants her values to last. So she absolutely believes that neighbors who are doing okay help neighbors who are not doing okay, and that is reciprocated later on in life in different instances. So that is one of her values, and she wants that to last. She really believes that adults should take care of children. There's a lot of children's charities in there because she wants that value to last. She wants to keep the kind of obvious one. She wants to keep supporting the people and projects she cares about. But she's also, and this is important, she's also from a time and place where giving back was just part of your civic duty. And that's been her lifelong thing. She's also a woman of deep, she's a Christian lady, and she very, very firmly believes in love thy neighbor as thyself. So her life is living that particular part of her faith. And she also has said, you know, probably I also wouldn't mind being, when people think of me, I want them to remember that I did some great things, right? So these are motivators, and if someone like me or someone like us is, you know, brought in to talk about how we can influence more people or speak to her, donors like her, knowing these kind of things and who they are can change our messaging absolutely, or just use certain words and respect certain values that we can use when we're talking to people. So I just wanted to use legacy donors as an example to illustrate how knowing that particular supporter group can help you then create copy accordingly. So some more things. So she has, for example, these same concerns, and research tells us that many charities, legacy donors have the same concerns. Very worried about being pestered. Do not want special treatment. This may be very different for your supporters, but the point is finding this stuff out. You know, if you're suddenly recognizing all of your legacy pledgers in the newsletter, and they have, that would be horrifying to Julie, I'm sure, horrifying to many people in that particular charity's profile, and don't want special treatment. And I have to say as well, many of the legacy donors I've interviewed, and when I've asked them about their support of other organizations, most organizations they haven't told. They haven't even told that they're, because that is very private. I would never tell them that, right? So those are all things that we really need to keep in mind. And again, that's just one group. So we like to sometimes start some of our training sessions with everybody pounding their chest and putting up their hands and saying, repeat after me, I am not the donor, I am not the donor. Because we find that we will impose kind of our thoughts and feelings on all of these different groups. So this is about being really careful not to make assumptions about who your supporters are, whether they're activists, whether they're donors, whether those wonderful people that do both. Because it's very likely that they're significantly different from you. Here is a case of point in point from one of the audits that I did last year that really, I think, proves why we have to challenge any assumptions that we're making about who our supporters are. So this was a really fun one for me because it was very different than most charities that I work with. It was an affiliate of the National Wildlife Federation, and they were anglers. It was like a steelheaders organization. So the members were all and predominantly guys who fish. So it's a fishing organization, not my standard kind of UNICEF, Oxfam, Amnesty work. But really, really interesting. So we, you know, one of the first things we said when we talked to them, like, everybody who fishes for a passion, for a hobby that I know is passionate, like crazy passionate about this. You know, surely if you've been a member for all these years, you want to, they might name you in their will, and legacies really are where we need to focus, and bequests where we need to focus. Well, absolutely not. We were told adamantly, 100%, you must never, ever speak to our members about leaving a gift in their wills, because these are not the kind of guys who will ever make a bequest to charity. They don't have enough money. They would think they would be offended about you talking to them about death. They just don't understand this type of giving. You must never, ever, we can never, ever do that. So we were a bit argumentative in a very nice, client-focused way. And over the couple months that we were working with them, Harvey and I just repeated this again and again, and we said, just let us test it. So we finally got the agreement to do a SurveyMonkey survey of all of their members. And we asked them, would you ever be interested in leaving a request to this organization that you're a member of in your will? And do you know about this type of giving? So I hope this shows up quickly. So I know that the bar on the bottom looks the most significant, but actually, they had about a 35% response rate overnight to this survey, from these people that they had also told us were not email responsive and probably never read their emails, etc. And 30% of them instantly said, yes, I would consider giving a donation to the Steelheaders organization in my will. 30%. And another, I think even possibly more interesting, another nearly 10% said, oh, yeah, I've left bequests in my will to other charitable organizations. Didn't think about it as being you. Didn't think that you would want one. So I haven't named you before, kind of thing. So if you think about the fact that for them, I think that's easily a few hundred people in a completely free, or possibly $40, I think, SurveyMonkey survey, have just found probably between 150 and 200 people who have, like that, been interested in leaving a request to these people in their, to this organization. Well, I mean, for them, they're a small organization. That, given the you know, average charitable request, and even if it's on the low side, that's transformative, right? So that these were assumptions that this group had had for like 10 or 20 years. Nobody had ever, ever given them permission to talk to their membership about requests. Similarly, and speaking about activists, we were also told, and I'm not trying to say this in any disrespectful way, this is just an example. These guys were great, like this organization is wonderful. They truly believed that we must never, that they must never send fundraising appeals to these members, because they felt that their membership was their fundraising and they volunteered so many hours that they would be really offended by receiving donor appeals. So we said, would you ever consider donating to the organization above and beyond your membership dues for river conservation, schools programs, veterans programs? And again, they had a massive response rate overnight. 80% of the people basically like buying into please send me a donation appeal. So I just love this because it's very kind of unorthodox, non-traditional donors, and it's an example of this the group of staff and executive directors and the board members who had one very firm and trying to be respectful set of opinions and had never asked, and their supporters were actually turned out to be quite different than they had ever anticipated. So how do we develop profiles of our donors? I just want to point to, because we don't have a load of time to go into this today, but it's things like depth interviews, focus groups, certainly written surveys. We've obviously just seen how well an email survey can do. But I just would like to point to, this is Nana Murphy, and she's kind of the pen portrait or donor profile that's being developed by this organization called Merchants Key Ireland. Does everybody know Sophie, the website resource called Sophie? Where you can, it's a showcase of creative and strategies based in the UK, but of fundraising from around the world. And it's sofii.org. It's absolutely brilliant. And you can find this case study there, with thanks to Lisa, Sandra, and Denise, who are the writers. And they worked to turn Merchants Key Ireland into this incredibly donor-centered organization, and the results have been phenomenal over the years of doing that. So don't have time to go into a lot of that today, but I really recommend it's free to download. So we believe, and we see from all of these audits and programs, that charities who are really focused on supporters rather than on channels, who identify first who their supporters are and who their potential supporters are, and then develop channels and messages to approach them, this whole siloing and this whole battle that goes on sometimes between should we do a print newsletter, should we do an email newsletter, should we have a direct mail program, or should we have a digital program, should we have, you know, should we focus on single gift donors, should we focus on monthly gift donors, becomes far less of a struggle because they've found a way to put the donor at the center of all of that, which of course does take processes and certain databases and all of that kind of thing, but it's there. Those are the ones that we can see still have income that is growing and growing and growing, which is not the case for everybody. So tip three, plan in an integrated and supporter-led fashion. And that's what this conference is all about, of course. But also, just as important, is counting in an integrated and supporter-focused way. And I'll give you two examples about why results analysis that focuses on more than one channel at a time is so important. So one of our clients, we helped them do some analysis. They were only able to do like results analysis of their direct mail and results analysis of their digital when it came to counting up all of their income over the year and various other streams. So we helped them do the analysis that looking at how many online gifts that came in had come from someone who had just received a direct mail pack or a printed newsletter. So they found that $200,000 of their online gifts in 2016 came from donors who had just received a direct mail pack. And I think the really, really important thing here is, though, that only 10% of those people used the special URL that we've all gone, you know, that we printed on the direct mail pack and, you know, totally rebelliously actually just went to their website, spent some time there, looked all around, and used the donation button on their website. So that's brilliant, but when it came to counting up incomes, if we hadn't been able to do that extra analysis, they would have thought that that was just kind of pennies from heaven money, right? They wouldn't have known where that money was coming from. So in this case, there would have been a lot of that $200,000 left on the table if it hadn't been this mixture of the direct mail pact prompting a gift, but a really good online donation facility to help mop it up because those people clearly didn't want to respond by direct mail or they wanted to go quickly respond by the website. So important that those two things work together. And just, you know, the very similar one that we did the analysis for, the online income for these guys went up from $7,500 to $126,000 over 3 years. And that's from direct mail. People who received a direct mail pack weren't receiving emails or anything else. Probably there was social media prompts and stuff as well. But they received a direct mail pack and then responded online. Which is all just to say that those two things really, really need to work together. Because if you have something going out in the mail, we know that more and more people come to the website to look and get extra information before they give. And the higher a donation that people are going to make, the more likely they are to come and check out the website first. If what's going on in the direct mail is not also reflected somewhere on your website, that's going to be a huge disconnect. It could really decrease results. So simply put, and this is where I always think that it's very obvious, but then we also do mystery shopper exercises that show that it's, you know, obvious but not necessarily being conducted, is that it really is about respect and about gratitude for people who are supporting us, no matter whether they're giving donations or whether they're supporting us in other ways. And I feel so strongly that we probably all learned those rules before we even reached kindergarten, right? But I think in our kind of post-automated direct response type world, you know, in the old days, people would know many of their donors, right? And now they're kind of numbers on our CRM databases. And there has been something lost, I think, in the personal relationship building and in the personal thanking and gratitude. So the rules really stay the same. And it just starts with thank you. And it seems so obvious, but we do these mystery shopper exercises, and I can tell you that the percentage of organizations that we vet, you know, thank promptly in a really genuine way in a letter that reflects the appeal that they came in on and gets all of the little things right is still less than 50%, I think, doing thanking and stewardship right. And we did a big, going back to our audits, we did a big audit for one of the large national health charities that has all of these provincial divisional offices. And we analyzed the direct response program for each of them and who was doing really well, what the kind of retention rates and average gifts and response rates were for each province across the country. And absolutely, those organizations that were doing a great thank you job, great job of showing impact. They were really sticking to the whole guideline of ask, thank, show impact, ask, thank, show impact. Their retention rates were much higher, significantly higher. Again, it's when you're trying to fight for budget and trying to save some budget, it's a very, very easy decision to take away the printed newsletter or some other kind of impact device like Victories Report or you know, annual report, although we kind of like scale down annual reports, and remove that altogether and just put it into an email. So a lot of times recently when I've been speaking to major donors or mid-level donors or monthly donors, one of the first things they will say is, yeah, I used to get a nice newsletter, and now they've turned it, you know, they're only sending it out by email, and I don't really read that, but I kind of miss the things that they were sending me. So I think it's a, we did an audit for a botanical garden, speaking to, and Marcia, who was leading on that, was speaking to a very significant donor, and this was one of the first things that this donor said, was I used to have this lovely printed newsletter, and I would leave it on my coffee table. Other people would come over and admire it, and of course, it's a botanical garden, so you can imagine the images are going to be lovely. And I don't get that anymore, and I really miss it. So I just think we don't want our major donors missing something as simple as a newsletter, right? So I don't think we can always assume that that what's cheaper is better. And we've done this has been repeated to me, like I said, in a couple of in at least two other surveys I've done with significant donors for organizations. So I would just be wary, even if something like a newsletter or an impact report is not bringing in a lot of money immediately, so it doesn't look very cost effective, or to be a huge income generator, I would just be very wary about, I don't know, throwing the baby out with the bathwater, I guess is the expression, and what the long-term impacts of that might be that you can't see instantly. So just to give you a few more insights into what major donors have said when I've been interviewing them for a variety of organizations lately. They really, really like having a named person at the charity to develop a relationship with. You know, you can do the whole sort of headshot and name and business card, if you will. And again, this is just particular organizations. This is the point being to find this out for your own. I miss the postcards UNICEF used to send me of the projects and kids my gifts are supporting. I used to put them up on my fridge, right? You have that on your fridge. I don't think you're going to stop your support anytime soon, right? You've got the UNICEF brand on your fridge constantly and the reminder of this child getting medicine because of you. And like I said, I put the charity newsletter on the coffee table and read it over again. Impact. The desire to be shown the impact of your gift in as specific a way as possible, which is very hard, I know, is not going away. So it's just staying. This person said, I don't like being overthanked, but I do feel strongly about being updated. Authenticity and trust. This person went so far, this was a major donor who went so far as to say he and his wife very specifically a condition of their giving of this large amount each year and pledging it for to do so for the next 4 years was that they wanted a very specific I don't think that we, impact doesn't go, the desire for impact and feedback is not going anywhere. Kevin's going to talk a bunch more about the Anyone But Conservative campaign, but I think it really highlights another finding we have, which is organizations, charities that are doing, whose income is growing, is are very, very kind of nimble and able to leverage good publicity. And possibly do a good job at handling bad publicity, I suppose, as well. This one that we spoke to, and they did not realize how many, just because they didn't have a kind of a very good database or paper trail and a lot of turnover, they didn't realize how many of their major donors had actually come to them because one of the big kind of big financial post type newspapers had picked them as a charity of the year one year, and that just it was interesting to find out that that's where these guys had all come from, right? I think they were expats and they were reading this and et cetera, et cetera. So they were, but again, if nobody, unfortunately, there is a lot of staff turnover in charities in our world. And so a lot of this information is lost unless we go back and ask people over and over again. And I think this is my final point before handing it over to you. The big question, and this is kind of a conference that's all about this, integration. Will we ever get people who are activists or non-donating supporters to support? And how much time should we spend trying to get them to do so? So in the old days when we could recruit donors for break-even or, you know, profit per new donor, nobody touched their activists, right? Nobody looked, went into their activist pool or went into their pool of volunteers or people who were supporting in a non-financial way. But these days, it's very often tends to be in direct mail or face-to-face or digital acquisition. Often, not always, tends to be quite a significant investment for each new donor, right? So now we're looking more strategically about how we get activists to donate. There still seems to be some assumptions that they won't, but we found. So we were working with a US-based advocacy organization, and interestingly enough, their activist engagement team was in Washington, D.C., and all their fundraisers were in New York, and that was kind of also symbolic of the relationship between them. They were just like, we must never touch each other's supporters, we must never kind of try to cross-pollinate any of this. But they had spent loads of money with CARE2 and with other Change.org and the Global Citizen rallies, recruiting all of these activists, which are great because they needed them for their policy work, but they somehow or other were all being left for at least 6 months to 12 months before they were ever finally receiving a fundraising ask. And the fundraising ask was about something completely different than what they had signed up and taken their initial action on. So as we've worked with a variety of organizations about how to get activists to give, those two things, and I'm sure Ryan from CARE2 would say the same thing, very, very timely follow-up with activists and testing out the perfect kind of sweet spot, if you will, of how to convert them into donors. We have, I know working with Amnesty, I think that they were like one extra engagement online and then a phone call, and that's their best way to convert their activists into supporters. And they were finding that they were actually their best source of monthly donors if they did so, but also having the content and the issue as closely connected as you can was massively important. So, yes, and that's how we sometimes do one of those kind of strategies of how to recruit activists and then convert them into donors. So for a real-life example that I think illustrates a whole bunch of these points, because it's much more exciting to hear examples than to just hear theory, Kevin's going to talk to you about the Anyone But Conservatives campaign and talk about your non-traditional and traditional media working together, right?
Right. Thank you, Lynn. Just checking everyone can hear me okay, be clear. So, as I said, my name is Kevin. I worked on the 2015 Canadian Veterans Anyone But Conservative campaign. This is a third-party election campaign we ran during the last federal election. And I'm just going to talk a little bit about the strategies and methods we used to grow our supporter base and mobilize them to take action. Everyone remembers this lovely guy? So over just under 10 years, a little history here, was Harper really angered the veterans for a number of reasons. Reduced services, closed Veterans Affairs offices, slashed staff budgets, even fought veterans in court over their payouts, generally failed them on a number of levels, and this really led to some staggering numbers. Suicide rates and homelessness among veterans skyrocketed during that time, so really quite upsetting. So Harvey and I both wanted to get involved for a personal reason and a strategic reason. Both of us have military veterans in our family. Harvey's father was a veteran. Both of my grandparents were veterans. I have an active military member in my family. And we were looking to get involved in the election, and the more we heard about the veterans, the more we dug into it, we found this was an area that really needed attention and that we thought maybe we could help. And so we reached out to a small grassroots group. They were two gentlemen out east who had a Facebook page of about 1,000 people. They were trying to make some noise and make this an election issue. We sort of reached out and asked if they'd be interested in having our help. They agreed, and so our main focus was to really raise the profile of the issue and get it out to as many Canadians as possible, and to use Harper's terrible track record to sort of dissuade voters from rewarding him with another term. Both of the other parties had promised packages that were much better than the Conservatives, so we figured if either party were to come into power other than the Conservatives, of course, veterans would be much better off. So as Lynn said, an important part of any campaign is starting with identifying your targets and your supporters, who you're trying to reach. And so we focused on three key audiences. So we had our swing voters, so people who were as of yet undecided. The soft Conservatives, people who had perhaps voted Conservative in the past, came from a Conservative family, but weren't completely on board. And then, most importantly, veterans and their families. And we felt that, you know, the vast majority of Canadians have at least one veteran, if not more, somewhere in their family tree. So we thought this was an issue that we could really try to connect with people personally, have them sort of take a look at how would you feel if this was your uncle, your aunt, your grandfather, something like that, that was being treated this way. We used three main avenues of engagement. So, of course, we had our online social media, as we already had the Facebook page, so we knew that would be sort of our home base. But we knew that would not be nearly enough. You know, the average age of veterans is significantly older than the average Facebook user, so we had to reach beyond the digital world, and so we attempted to get into traditional media, print, radio, TV, anything we could. And then on-the-ground support. And on-the-ground support in the form of signs worked very well for us. We actually ran an Indiegogo campaign that was part fundraiser, part message amplifier. And we did that by selling signs, buttons, even giving away quite a large number of them as well. And this really helped us with our on-the-ground game. We had signs in communities across the country, and so that got us out of the digital world, out of the media as well, sort of gave it a bit of a grassroots feel. So instead of being this social media campaign, it was actually small communities, a lot of veterans all across the country participated. And even better, we were able to, we asked some of them to send pictures with their signs, and if with their permission, we'd reshare them on social media, so a way of sort of interacting with the supporters and giving them a bit of a shout out on social media for the actions they had taken. It was extremely popular. Our signs sold out. We had more demand than we could possibly print. Memes were another very powerful tool. I'm sure you're all very aware, but a meme should be very brief, understandable in 5 to 8 seconds. It sort of hits you as soon as you see it. You don't need to think too much. It's just easily digestible. And the best ones convey some sort of emotion, whether it's anger and sympathy or laughter, which was a difficult one with our particular campaign, but we did try. And really tried to make it relatable to people. So you can see some of our memes there and some of the staggering numbers, completely unacceptable. So we thought getting this information in front of Canadian voters would really impact them. And a few more, and you can see these we came up with our target audiences in mind. So military member families, maybe soft Conservatives, people that weren't that happy with Harper, general population that wasn't too sure where they fell on the spectrum, all these sort of things, trying to make it a quick and easy but emotional appeal. Videos and storytelling. So all throughout we were getting unbelievable stories, some very heartbreaking stories. And most of these would come through our Facebook page. People seem to use it as a bit of a sounding board. They didn't necessarily have an outlet, it seemed. So once they got the chance, they would just vent to us on our Facebook page. We would contact some of these people and ask if they'd be interested in sharing their stories with the public. Many of them we encouraged to write letters to their editor, or to the editor of their local newspaper, and several of which were published. And we reached out to a group as well to participate in a video. And this video on the left here, Families Left Behind, was extremely did extremely well for us. Very emotional. Four widows of veterans who had received terrible treatment under the Conservative government. And the video reached 400,000 in the last 3 days of the election. In fact, all of our videos, due to a bit of time constraint and resource limitations, were all released within the last 10 days. but they were reached by or viewed by hundreds of thousands of Canadians across the country. For those of you that like numbers, here's a bit of some data for you. You can see most of our videos did very well under a cost or under cent per reach. And again, all these are just within a number of days. You can see the dates there, so they were within five to, I think one was 9 days ahead of time, and the rest were all within the last 5 days. And this resulted in some excellent media coverage. You can see a few highlights here. It was really important for us to get into the media again, to reach beyond our social media campaign. And this also led to some really great video and TV and radio interviews. We got on a whole bunch of different national news programs. And you can see also, note this slide is from a thank you package that was sent out to our supporters after the election. Sort of show how their support had impacted the election, how their money had been spent, and it was another way of reporting back to your supporters. We use riding-specific Facebook audiences. We created them based on usually postal codes, but there's some funny business around postal codes were not all to be accepted, so we would have the pin drop method, but this is a bit more detail I can get into with anyone that's curious after the fact if you're willing to chat with me. But this also allowed us to give riding-specific endorsements towards the end of the campaign. This was done because we were receiving a number of questions about who to vote for. Our slogan was always, vote for the candidate with the best chance to defeat a conservative in your riding. Of course, it's not easy to determine all the time, so we used the best polling we could. Made a number of endorsements in key ridings that we focused on that were swing ridings. And I think we won, or well, I can't say we won, but the candidates that we selected won in all, but I believe nine or so out of the 40-some-odd we chose. And resulted in millions of Canadians being reached on Facebook, Twitter, and through our videos. Our Twitter campaign was cited as one of the top campaigns or top accounts during the election season. And we even won two awards from the Reads organization for Best Digital Video for our Families Left Behind video and Best Canadian Digital Campaign. All of this led to a drop in support. Obviously, we cannot take credit for these numbers alone. There's a lot of groups that were working on these issues and pushing hard for this. But this sort of makes us feel a little bit better where 7.7% drop in support nationally. Canadians living abroad, that was down to 12% of a drop. And that's mostly, not mostly, but a significant portion were military families living abroad. And 15% on average in these key 10 ridings that we focused on that all had a military base, so really strong military presence. More than double, well, just about around double the national average. And finally, Harper defeated. I think most of us in this room are probably pretty happy about that. And we knew we were effective, at least in some regard, because the conservative MP in the riding of our founder in Nova Scotia mentioned to them that they were completely caught off guard. They were not expecting the veterans issue to be on the radar at all. They sort of thought that was their key stronghold of military families, and we were able to sort of use that as a weak point to really change the outcome, or you know, impact the outcome. And that's about it. We were pretty successful. Obviously, you know, we can't claim full responsibility, and there's a lot of people that worked very hard on this. So yeah. Any questions at all?
Any questions about any part of the...
Either part of
the
yes.
Or... talking about... Hello. Yeah.
How effective actually is fake news?
Obviously pretty effective, unfortunately.
Yeah, this recent U.S. election gives us any indication. It's a tough question. It's... You know, it's not looking great right now, but it's a bit of a gray area. You know, I don't really know.
Because I've used all the same
there's not
groups,
a lot of resources
and targeting,
yeah.
And
yeah.
Selection.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, ideally, it's not fake news. You know, you'd like to be able to use targeting to promote an honest message, but obviously you can't control. In fact, Trump famously used Facebook targeting extensively in his campaign to his benefit, obviously, in a way that's never been seen before, never been possible before. Quite interesting.
On a postal code basis.
Exactly. Yeah, riding by riding.
I was wondering, is there anything you do differently in the planning of the campaign and now that you know what the outcome is?
Yeah, good question. excuse me. I think one of the key things was our on-the-ground strategy suffered a little bit because, you know, the main supporter base were military members, veterans, and their families. A lot of the guys that were the most adamant supporters had post-traumatic stress disorders or physical disabilities, things like that, that sort of prevented them from getting out there. We did attend rallies, we handed out leaflets and things like this, but I think we would have tried to expand our ground game a little more and get more non-military members and non-veterans involved. But a lot of this was sort of done on the way and down, a shoestring sort of resource limit or resource and time limit here. So it was a little challenging, but that would be one area we would have improved for sure.
Another question,
too,
just
coming
out of that.
Sure.
Did you find, like, when you were doing the Facebook advertising, did you end up getting a particular segment of veterans, or was there a pretty representative cross-section?
Yeah, so well, with our Facebook advertising, we didn't focus specifically on veterans per se. We would focus on ridings. I could say, I guess, we focused on veterans by choosing ridings around military bases and things like that. But we just focused on voting age and above. Generally didn't usually add too many interests or other characteristics, and tried to reach as wide of an audience amongst voters in those ridings as we could, especially amongst family members. We found we did reach a higher number of women through a lot of our campaigns, especially our families video was quite significantly more viewed by more women than men. But yeah, that's it.
What was that one question?
Sorry?
That one.
The video. Oh, I see. Yes. Good question also. We were trying to keep them under a minute or around a minute. But again, you do see, as I'm sure many of you know, that the view times drop off significantly after those first 5-10 seconds, depending on. But what we were happy with was we did see significant numbers sticking through to the very end. So while it did tail off, we would get people to about a minute at least, but I think that's sort of pushing it really. Ideally, it'd probably be a little bit shorter than that, but these days it's sort of changing quite quickly. People's attention spans on Facebook are apparently dropping. So.
Go ahead. No, you first. How did you measure conversion? So, I mean, there was a kind of societal appetite to get rid of Harper, but you know, you also did convert some. So, how did you measure the difference between that kind of growing appetite of distaste versus conversion?
Yeah, that's a good question as well, and we didn't really have a direct method for measuring. We were sort of we did some testing and see what would work best just through Facebook testing, sort of A and B options. And we would sort of use the limited data that we had to just go on gut and try different options and keep trying different things and seeing what worked. But as far as reporting, you know, it was kind of another weak spot in our campaign. But again, the objective wasn't really for donations, it was more for influencing voting, getting people to change. And so the best we can do really is point to some of the numbers, drops in support in writings that we targeted. And we did fairly well, but again, there were many groups in those writings as well, so we can't take credit.
Question for you. When you're doing your stakeholder engagement work and you have to present to a board or to the client,
yes.
How do you go about telling them that difficult news and trying to persuade them into taking that direction so that you can do that additional work? Because I know that
in terms of things like investing in stewardship and
just getting them to really
supporters are.
Yeah, buy into things that they're not super wanting to buy into.
Well, I think a couple things happened for some reason, even though there's incredible expertise in nonprofit organizations. Some people will be more persuaded by having an external voice come in, and I might be saying the exact same thing that everybody else has been saying for since the dawn of time, but there's a bit of extra. But I think also that's why the quotes from donors can be so powerful, right? From donors or supporters or prospective, and I mean, I think it just is the fact, if I can say, so the person who really wants your newsletter gave you $250,000 this year, just say this is their feedback, right? That's that really helps. So I do think, I mean, we all know that, you know, kind of qualitative research has its limitations because people will say something different in a focus group than they are their actual behavior later. But I think that all of those things that are coming from the horse's mouth, as it were, really do help in any time I'm doing a presentation like that.
Okay, awesome.
You said traditional media was a part of your strategy from the get-go, but I'm curious, how much of the coverage was sort of proactive on your part, and how much was outlets approaching you when your campaign gained traction?
Yes, good question. In fact, I did skip over that, the point point I wanted to make, so thank you for bringing that up. We were releasing press releases quite regularly throughout the campaign. We initially were reaching out to a lot of different organizations. Tai published a few of ours, thanks to a sort of a mutual connection that we had. And it became one of the most shared stories, in fact, 11,000 shares on the website, the most during the election. But as things started to snowball, agencies began reaching out to us. And so once our video started to take off, once we started to get, we had a few radio pieces that did very well, and we would see that reflected in our social media as well. There'd be a lot of uptake in activity during those. And that seemed to get more people's interest, and towards the last week to 2 weeks, we were getting calls from reporters to try to speak to our representatives and things like that. So it was initially very proactive on our part to try and put up press releases, contact agencies. We were phoning radio stations, phoning newspapers, local and national. But again, sort of the snowball effect, so it picked up and then sort of got legs on its own.
I'm curious about, if this is just tangential. So I clearly fall outside of your target demographic. However, I was aware of your campaign, but not until today did I know it was associated with veterans, which I find fascinating. So from a marketing perspective, I'm wondering, did you measure, were you aware of that, the reach that your campaign had way outside of your intended audience and what that was, how it was perceived outside of that?
Yeah, well, that was definitely our goal, was to get beyond our core audience, sort of get away from the echo chamber of our own supporters. We want to reach people that we can really impact and change their vote. So it was absolutely an objective of ours. The ABC election strategy was not our initial idea either. It had been used before in previous elections and was begun this time by the grassroots group that we sort of started with. As far as measuring how that got out there, really only point to some of the media coverage that we received and things like that, but
it's a good point though, because it might have been, you know, had there been ability and time to test before, you know, basically had we started earlier.
Yeah,
there could certainly have been a case to be made for having a different name, right? That does what it says on the tins and had veterans right there in the name.
Perhaps
a little bit. Yeah. So you could make up another argument, which was because awareness of veterans issues, what it was your backup. It wasn't your primary. Your primary goal was to defeat Harper, and you did, like, that campaign does that,
right?
And so it could be easily accessed by people.
Sure. Yeah.
It's kind of symbiotic, but
yeah,
it's really just personal affiliation with the veterans' causes and stuff. But it could be too. So because we had to whip through, I've actually brought some top tens that give more of the tips. So the 10 now is out. Sorry, go ahead.
One last.
Oh, yeah, I'll bring them over.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right, well, we're out of time. Thank you very much, everyone.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, I think we're ready. It's funny because we thought it was 90 minutes. So then I looked, 90 minutes. And so then I timed it out, and we said something else for notes, and so I timed it out kind of in a moderate pace. Stuff. So I was adding some more little things, asking additional questions. And then yesterday she's like, we've got 75 minutes. I'm like, oh, okay, well, we'll take some stuff out and we'll go at normal pace that we're used to going. So, yeah.
So,
this is. Yeah, I know. And you told me not to heckle us.
For the next day,
yeah,
things are
yeah, we are going to, yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Why don't you come up here with us? Yeah. Yeah,
and
well,
that'll be cool to be next segment when everybody else wants to heckle you.
Yeah, do you want to come up here? Well, I think the thing I like about the Cooper's Emmy part is that I can speak here from a perspective, but Lisa and Veronica was able to speak here from me. Everyone here lives and breathes, right? Wanting to know kind of, how do you guys really feel, not just like what she has to say.